every circumstance and every situation. I'm just going to read one verse in Luke chapter 18, verse 1. He spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Let us pray. Eternal God, our gracious loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that thou, the God of all creation, seem fit to dwell with men, the person of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ. When we live upon this earth, not only lived a life of prayer, but we taught men how to pray. We ask, Lord, even as we come tonight, that thou teach us to pray, that we may find ourselves in the place of prayer, as our Savior so often set apart himself to the place of prayer. We thank thee that we can come to the throne of grace through the merits of thy own dear Son, who is now our High Priest interceding on our behalf. We thank thee that for the Holy Spirit of God, who enables us to pray with groanings which cannot be uttered, for we know not what we ought to pray for. We thank thee that if this is all possible because of the finished work of Christ on the cross there at Calvary, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, suffering the shame, my shame, taking upon himself my sin, being made a curse for me, a curse under the law, but yet triumphant, victorious through his own precious blood, he rose victorious, and we thank thee as we cry, oh, what a Savior, oh, hallelujah, a blessed Savior indeed he is to us. As he has taught us and given us this command and instruction, dear Lord, I pray that I'll take the next few moments of our time, and may our attention be directed to Christ's word. Move the preacher into the shadows. May we see Christ. Maybe, as in word was sung already, may we sit at the feet of Jesus. May we find ourselves at his feet. So be pleased, O Lord, to use my feeble instrumentality and draw people's hearts to Jesus' blood and to his righteousness. And then that we may have an interest in the souls of men who are dying and going to hell today. Bless thy word to our hearts. Speak to us now, shut us into thyself. May they be a word this season. Lord, as we come to thy words, I pray that I'll make much of Christ, that we will see much of him, that we will desire to be more Christ-like. So bless thy word. There is one without Christ, may they come to know the Savior. And Lord, for a backslider, they may repent of their sin and return to their first love. I pray for Christians. We may examine our own hearts in light of the Scriptures. Holy Spirit of God, bring conviction. May we be convicted in this area that so often we take for granted and many a time we fail. I pray, Spirit of God, speak to our hearts. Speak to every Christian today. Great conviction, and may we desire to be like Jesus. So we come in this time, bless thy word to our hearts, for without thee I can do nothing, I can say nothing, I need thy help. Give to me the unction of the Holy One, Lord, grant to me of power and to us. Loosen my tongue, and speak to hearts then, even in this hour. We commend this time to thee, asking for thy will to be done, God mine. I give thee all the honor, glory, and praise for what thou art going to do. I do ask all these things in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen. Go back and look at Luke chapter 17. The Lord Jesus Christ gives us the background and the events that will surround tells us the days in which we will find ourselves in. Days of Noah, wherein people ate, drank, married, and so on. And so also, likewise, also it was in the days of Lot. You see, the Lord gives us, and you find, and then he goes down and he talks about those who will be caught up, and so on, and so forth. Two women grinding, and one shall be taken, the other left. Two men in the field, the one shall be taken, the other left. And then he comes and he's going to expound, as we often say, a parable is a heavenly story with an earthly meaning. It has a story that relates to us. Here you find that very clearly. Isn't it quite interesting that the days of Lot were days of sodomy? Days where homosexuality was rampant. They tried to push it on everybody else. You find in the days of Lot, even when the angels came to take Lot out of Sodom and Gomorrah, they came to the door and knocked and said, "Give us those men." That's how wicked and vile they were. God would therefore judge them with fire and brimstone. The days of Noah were days when, as the Bible says, they drank. They ate, drank, married wives, were given in marriage. You see that happening today. Both those events, although they were at separate times in Scripture, we find that the Lord Jesus says that before he comes back to this world, they both will be there together, culminating. Therefore, in his return, when he comes, this is how wicked and vile the world is going to be. He says, in the midst of all of this, we find ourselves in the midst of all of this. He says in Luke 18, verse 1, men ought always to pray. Is it because men were not praying? Or is it because men were not praying enough? Well, we often know when circumstances take place, we tend to complain rather than pray. And the Lord is telling us here, these are the days you are going to find yourself in before I come. As I said, when Sodom and Gomorrah, their sin, God destroyed. And then, of course, when you come, you have the days of Noah. Again, not too long after, maybe a couple hundred years, maybe 1,000 years later, the world being destroyed by a flood. But now, as we come and look forward to the coming of Christ, both of these is what is going to prevail in this world. And you look very carefully. The Sodomites are on the rise. They've even said they want to get our children. They want to go after our children. And there's nothing wrong. They're pushing themselves. They're knocking at our doors, as it were, as it was in the days of Lot. You look at the lifestyle of people who have no fear of God. We just are living for the now. We're living for today. Eat, drink, and enjoy is their slogan. There's no fear of God. There's no desire for God. There's no delight in the things of God. Unless we be sidetracked and our eyes be driven away, the Lord says, listen, in the midst of this turmoil, in the midst of all that is taking place, what should you and I do? choice for you and me, but it's a command for us to pray. Of course, we may say, well, I choose to pray, I feel when I can pray, but the Lord Jesus Christ very clearly teaches us here that you ought to pray. There's no option here. When things are bad, when things are not going right, when you find yourself in such a situation as just described, the days of Lot and the days of Noah, what should you do? Don't give in. Don't get caught up. But instead, get to your knees and start to pray. My friends, it's a command to each one of us. You have no choice in the matter if you're a child of God. You ought to recognize how important it is for you and I to pray. So I'm going to go through this very quickly. I'm not going to develop it as I would like to, because I want to get also to the hymn story. And I'm hoping once again to finish, because I know tomorrow is a day off, but I want to finish before midnight, so that's my plan, all right? So, but nonetheless, you find that the Lord commands us to pray. Why don't we have the power over what is going on? It's because we do not pray. One of the saddest stories I've often told you is Matthew chapter 17, where you have the account of the disciples, and they come down. This is just after they come down from the Mount of Transfiguration. Here they've got a wonderful vision of Christ, and Peter tells us they spoke of his suffering that should come. And these disciples heard it. In fact, Peter said, well, let's go through altars till he heard that voice from heaven saying, Peter, you don't know what you're talking about. Jesus may have been talking to Moses and Elijah, but Moses and Elijah are one man. This is my beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased. And so from this great time of prayer, as it were, on that mountain, and seeing the Lord, as it were, in a time of prayer, talking about the suffering that should follow, they come down. And there's a man who brings his son to them. But they could do nothing, because it says, verse 14, and when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man, kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic and sore vexed. For oftentimes he falleth into the fire, and oftentimes into the water. Notice these words, verse 16. I brought him to thy disciples, and they could not what? What a sad, sad situation. These men were, as it were, on a mountaintop, but they couldn't do this. Of course, Jesus rebukes the devil, verse 18. You know that happens today. The pastors who are called upon to deal with situations like this, because this devil is still real. The devil is here. Of course, if you're saved,
fact that the Lord next to say men ought to tells me that the Lord is saying men don't pray like they should. The Lord is saying now, you don't pray like you should, and therefore you don't have power to live the Christian life, to live the victorious Christian life, because you're not doing what you ought to be doing. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, they that wait upon the Lord, they that pray, waiting upon the Lord is praying, waiting upon Him in prayer, shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall walk and not be weary. They shall run and they shall not faint. You see, the illustration there again in Isaiah is very poignant, because they say the eagle has one of the sharpest eyes. It can look down from a very, they say almost 7,000 to 8,000 feet, that's what they say. Quite high. Maybe even 10, I don't know exactly. They can look down and see their prey all the way down, and it has, you know, for example, when you travel flying an airplane, you notice that the airplane comes and he pauses for a moment, he revs up his engines, getting them to where he needs them to be, and normally when they are taking off, their engines rev up to almost 400 miles, 300 to 400 in between, depending on the wind. They said they need to have that power to propel them, to lift the plane up, and at that speed, between 300 and 400 miles, they come at that speed, and with the wind going against them, that's when the plane lifts up. And it's the speed that propels them to go forward. That's why their engines are very powerful, because they need that power. You'll never see an airplane coming down like this and going up again, you understand? Because it can never do that. The power is not there. But you will see an eagle doing that, because it has so much power. It can just come down in one swoop and take its prey and take off. You see, that's what the analogy that Isaiah gives to us. And it's what the Lord is saying to us. You don't have this power. You give up in praying. You pray for some time, but you give up. The Lord is saying, you ought to be doing this. What is it? What are some of the questions or hindrances that so often prevent us from praying like we should? You write them down yourself. That's an assignment for you, all right? I never give assignments in Sunday services, but that's an assignment for you, all right? Go back to your room tonight and write down, what is it that hinders me from praying like I should? Take a piece of paper, be honest with yourself, and say, why don't I pray like I should? The Lord says men ought always to pray. Why am I not finding myself in that situation? But then, there is a challenge. No, the Lord said men ought always to pray, not to faint. The Lord says to us, the days ahead are challenging days. You need to always be in the place of prayer. That's a challenge to us. To always be in a state of prayer. That spirit of prayer. If you go to the early church in the New Testament, the great fear that has come upon the people. They can go and fight. They have no other way whereby they can do anything. To Acts chapter 12, verse 1, Herod, the king, stretched forth his hands to the excerpt of the church, and he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And then, because it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. What can we do? Who can we find who will help us in this situation? Well, the answer comes to us in verse number 5. Peter therefore was kept in prison. But what? Prayer was made. How often?
Without ceasing.
Without ceasing. Luke chapter 18, what did Jesus say? Men ought how often?
Pray always.
Always. But that's the great challenge for me. To be always stirred.
And they would just stand and listen as he was just
This man is praying. It was always in that spirit of prayer. And he prayed and prayed. He memorized scripture. He prayed and he preached. Imagine that, all right? How wonderful that must be. Thomas Salmon, a New York native, came there to Bull's Hill, Warwickshire, England. When he came to know William Walford, he tells the story of what happened while he was visiting this wonderful, I should say, pastor, a blind pastor. He said, I sat there and he was talking to me, and he repeated two or three pieces or lines which he had composed. And having no friend at home to commit them to paper, he had just put them up in the storehouse that he had in his little home. Then when he came, he said, well, could you take that down? How do you think? What do you think of these words? How will this do? Yes. Then he repeated the following lines with a complacent smile, the author says. Touched with some light lines of fearless, he subjects himself to criticism. He was, what if I'm saying the wrong thing, or I have something wrong? But he didn't realize Thomas, son, while he was reciting these lines, he quickly ran and took a piece of paper and a pencil, and he copied the lines from what he had, and then he started, when he was speaking to him, he started writing these other lines as well. He came up with four sentences that he copied, and he wrote. It doesn't tell us where the music came from. But Mr. Thomas, when he got back to New York, he sent this poem that was written to a magazine called The Observer, which was a Christian magazine. And they inserted it in that, he sent it there for insertion in The Observer and said, I'm sending this to you, I'm not sure, but if you should think them worthy of preservation, would you kindly insert this into your that book? The recipient and the observer considered them worth preserving. That poem, whatever he wrote, was published on September 13th, 1845, becoming a beloved hymn of the Methodist Church. First of all, it was included in the Methodist kingdom, then made its way to the Baptist kingdom. The title of that song, which we so often sing, and I hope you pay attention to the words, at least today as we sing, is the words, sweet hour of prayer. This blind man spent hours in prayer. It was healing. That's what it was. If you notice, the last few lines always of each stanza, he speaks of being at the feet of Jesus Christ, and he speaks of that. The Lord said, the days before his return are going to be perilous days. Days wherein they'll be scrambled and sin. themselves to prayer. One day, they felt a burden to pray for their idols. 10 or 12,000 people on the islands. God would turn that idols around. They were praying and praying and praying, and they called their local pastor to come to the house. They said, "Pastor, we need someone to come, I think." It's time for what? I think it's time God wants to meet with us. It's time for revival. Is there someone you know? He said, "Well, there's a gentleman I know. I'll try to get hold of him, but he's a very busy man. But I'll try to get hold of him. And I'll let you know." So he sent off a message, wrote a letter to Mr. Cunningham, who replied and said, "Those days will not work for me because I'm booked all the way through. I've got meetings scheduled two weeks at a time, or 1 week at a time." And he wanted him to come here for 2 weeks. He said, "I want you to come for 2 weeks." He said, "I can give you maybe a few days. Weeks. So he came back and told these new ladies that I contacted him. Doesn't seem to work because the gentleman's schedule is too tight. He can't pay. They kept praying, they kept praying, they kept praying. A couple of weeks later, they called the pastor in again. He came to visit them and they said, "Pastor, call him again." He said, he tried to say, "You know, listen, he already told me that he can't make it. I'm not going to ask him again." The blind lady right in front of the pastor, she said, "Lord, I'm telling this man, this pastor, to call Duncan Campbell, and he's not calling. Give him my heart to call that man again. You understand?" So the pastor felt really bad. So he went and wrote again. Mr. Duncan Campbell wrote back and said, "You know what? Some of my meetings just got canceled. I can give you 2 weeks. I'll be there." And he came. He says, "I preached for a week. On that particular day," he said, "I tried to preach and I just felt heaven was closed." He said, "I saw a young lad in the front. His head bowed and tears rolling down his cheeks just dropping to the floor. He said, I could preach no further. I just stopped and I said, Tom, will you pray for us?" Tom was reading from the Revelation, book of the Revelation that day. He just stood up. He said, "Lord, I know you're in the heavens. Rend the heavens open and pour out your spirit on us." He said, God started to work. People started to